restart the recording? There we go. Okay. That way when we go to the VODs and stuff later. Okay, so now we're going to get into our normal Sunday stuff. Completing Bayonetta Origins took a little bit longer than I expected, by not a small amount, but that's fine. It's fine, I guess. Anyway. Okay, so we're going to get started on the reaction side of things. We do have 5 things to react to, as well as a conversation to have. I'll remind everyone of what we're reacting to. Crime Boss, Rockay City, Terra Nil, Ravenbound, Dredge, and Tainted Grail, The Fall of Avalon. And we're also going to have a conversation in there about Game of the Year and remakes. So, let's start with the fucking weirdest one, which is going to be this one. So, the way that this works, everybody, is that I'm going to read an introduction off the top of my head, and then we will check out a set of trailers together, and then afterwards we'll talk about the trailers. Then when it feels like the conversation is starting to come to an end, or it's just time to go, I will read an outro, and then we'll make faces. Face gets used in the thumbnail, rinse, and repeat. We do these live on stream because they make for a more interactive and dynamic experience, both for myself as the content creator, as well as people that'll be watching it later on YouTube. Sure, we'll use this one. All right. So, then you can also say hi to the new YouTube video using either this emote if you have BTTV, this emote if you're a subscriber, or you can use any other emote. It could be for my channel, your channel, or anyone else's. Just a way to move the chat along, clear it up before we get started on the video. Work with me here. There we go. All right, here we go. Greetings and salutations. My name is Michael Schwann, and today we are checking out Crime Boss Rockay City. Now, Rockay City was shown off at, I think, the Game Awards, and it was one of the most weird, wild announcements. They had a whole bunch of celebrities. Like, you can even see in this picture, you got, like, Al Pacino and Chuck Norris and Vanilla Ice and stuff in here. And it looked like it wanted to be, like, Grand Theft Auto, but had, like, a tenth of the budget. But all of the budget went to getting the celebrities on board, and the gameplay that they showed off was questionable. At best, we are going to watch the initial announcement trailer. There's been a little bit more footage that has come out since then, like a little bit of gameplay footage and the Lost Candy trailer, which sounds like it's going to get this video flagged for content, but you know, it is what it is. So we'll find out hopefully a little bit more about what this game is. Hang on, I got to see what this is right here. Because this looks like something else. I mean, this is the game, but it did not pop up when I was grabbing the trailers. So let me see what the date on this one is. February 9th. And this one is Pause You. This is February 16th. All right, you get to go right there. Congratulations. All right, here we go. Gonna go on a little adventure.
So you wanna be a criminal, do ya? Game on!
See, like, celebrity names after celebrity names. I said Al Pacino earlier. I meant Danny Trejo. Sorry, I'm good with names. Danny Glover got named Gloves. You kidding me? See, again, they showed just enough gameplay that, like, especially in this initial segment right here, like, where's this, like, first-person shooter segment that they showed off? Where was it? Like, it was... This looks so janky right here. Like, this looks like, development early alpha Call of Duty footage. All right, anyway, so that was from the Game Awards back on December 8th. All December 9th, here's some gameplay for it.
Okay, your brain's about to stop. You need to keep an eye
Find the gear bag.
Find the rope close by. Look around.
The crazy looking pistol. They went from the most jank ass on your dad's shotgun shelf to weird ribbed for her pleasure pistol. How was I supposed to know that was there?
Get the rope set up and get down to the skylight.
I like how they did the slow pan of like, look how good this looks. When you got the most tessellated ass water on the screen.
That's fucking high.
The skylight is what the statues are being lifted through.
Boss, we made it to the lobby.
It was a rough cut. Oh, do we change who we're controlling? How many players is this? Is this all single player? Do I need to coordinate with... No, that's the same person that was upstairs, but we got a different pistol in our hands. But that's the... Okay, that's the person that was earlier, because I noticed the hands were black. This person's hands are white, and he has the pistol with the weird slide on it. It's like Payday meets Rainbow Six.
Handle the business.
Dude didn't even notice the door open.
Mira, it's moving.
I'm amazed. Are there buildings that are actually like that? Cause that's freaking cool. I mean, stadiums do that. That's true. But that was like curved glass.
That was big.
We're in, but that's still on. Find the right vault.
Let's find the dogs and get out safe.
Get ready to go hunt.
Stinger, Jupiter, Mr. X, and Clutch. And each person can go down like a certain number of times, it looks like. Because they have like little skulls next to their names, next to their health bars.
Here we go. She's opening.
The Akajimba. Both photos are in here. They will be here.
Massive jade statues. Getting shot.
Let's hope that straightened out the situation.
Wires coming through the skylight.
This is so extra. He's bleeding out fast. feel like video games address well enough, like, what grenades would do to an indoor environment. Hang on one second. No, don't adjust volume. I want to see if anything when they got up changed on... Yes, they lost one of their little death cards. It went from 5 to 4. Okay. Here's the Lost Candy trailer. That was really loud. First episode, Lost Candy.
Rocky City. Wow. What they used to call it? The crown jewel of Florida. Oh, I got the crown part right. Pretty goddamn accurate.
But...
Fuck, man, I was goddamn handsome back when I moseyed into Rocky, fixing to take the whole town by storm. Hiya, Casey, lordy lord. You're looking dynamite.
Why, thanks.
The blues come in yet? You know, the little ones with my hat on them.
Those pills ship in tonight. We'll be good to go.
Well, I think it's time that we giddy up.
Alrighty, okay.
Choose goal, Candyman. So it's mission oriented?
By whom? Rappers?
Don't you lose my candy, God. Damn it.
It's yellow. Come in to plunder our loot. Do not let it happen.
Shit, that's a lot of them. Take them all.
Is that how the mission starts like that? Ooh, the blur.
More rounds. Yeah, got you. That's it. Behold here.
That dude got fucking wrecked. Yeah, yeah. Ow. Why does this look like somebody's initial project of proving that, like, they could make an FPS? Not even a proof of concept. Like, somebody grabbed a bunch of assets off of the Epic Store, and we're just like, I figured out how to make an FPS game, guys. Look, I even put, like, some cars onto this bridge so that you'd have a place to fight at.
What the fuck happened?
Sir, the blues and all the drug... candy was taken.
And it was this fucker, Yellow, who Casey told me about?
A rival dealer in the party scene. Yellow.
Yeah, Yellow. Don't fucking correct me. Now get it back before dawn.
Okay. So that was a supposed to lose fight? I know people are very protective of the sweets, but this might be a bit excessive. Okay, so this is the second episode, Helos Yellows. Helios? I don't know. Anyway, let's play the fucking trailer.
Yo, Carlos. Woo, looking fly, son.
Baker's Blue X. All of it!
This look fun.
Stay off the candy, bitch.
Hey, be nice to the talent, man. Yo, yo, aren't you Clutch's sister? Nothing gold could stay, huh?
Why are the pills called blues? Are they downers?
What? No, man. They're fucking blue.
Ah, branding. Your blues are spreading throughout Rockay.
Fucking yellow. Little bastard needs an ass whooping.
Oh, we hire dudes? We have like some sort of money management system going on in here? You can only bring as many dudes as you can hire? Because there was room for another one.
Low and slow? Or a fucking ruckus? What's it gonna be? Now, just how big a fucking message should we send? There they are, Yellow's fruity Chicos.
You do have the ability to switch control to different party members.
It's open. Got a sign.
Those red face fucks are hawking my shit.
Let's get it all.
We have a money bag bar. So, you know, the thing is, not a chance in hell I would pay money for this.
Quiet ain't happening.
But if I could play it on Game Pass, I would probably be willing to give it a try. God, it's so janky, though.
Push! Some damn thank you.
That's it.
Are you certain?
Yeah.
The escape vehicle will be arriving shortly.
Yep.
All right, now, let's make the King's Party a fucking killer event. Let's fucking roll, man.
I'm coming in.
That's half.
Get the bags in.
It's so video gamey.
Get in quickly.
How about grabbing more cash?
It's also very jarring when gameplay demos don't show too much in the way of tactics in an FPS game. Like, just walk out slowly and shoot things, right?
Let us go.
But it's also not even like arcadey, where it would be like, uh-huh. Like that first showcase felt like Rainbow Six-y. What?
Baker snatched his blues back?
Ah, those blues are the best.
Shut it, bitch. Yellow man, that's my bad.
Yo, I ain't with that.
Oh, with that? The King's part is gonna be off the hook.
Shut it, bitch.
From now on, when Baker makes a dollar, however or wherever, I'm gonna take it from him. Word to your mother.
And our yellows?
Duh, you gotta push them pills harder, dog. Box the candy man out.
Good luck with that.
Bitch, shut the hell up. Okay, you ready?
We rule everything.
There's still more. There's one more. It's definitely meant for a very specific audience with the movie star lineup. Yeah, but you can also tell they're hyper phoning in these performances too. They read the script once and read the line twice.
Hello everyone, and thank you for tuning in to learn more about Crime Boss Rockay City. My name is Damien Poitier, and not only will you see me in the game as the character Nisara, but I've also had the honor of being part of the writing team for the game, helping in-game studios bring the criminal underworld of Rockay to life. In this video, I want to spend a little time to show you the different modes and in-game features you will experience in Crime Boss Rockay City. This will help you get a better picture of what it takes to be
like,
a
like, sure,
crime
you
boss.
Can get a bunch of celebs, but could you also make a decent-looking game? I don't need the game to like, literally look photorealistic, right? Like, I love games as long as the game is a decent game. But I'm not sure if this is it.
Quick money and big rewards. When we want to carry out a small hit, we can jump to the map where they are randomly generated. They are small, opportunistic jobs that would naturally present themselves in a city such as Rockay. So there are always plenty to choose from. Once we see one that we like, we can move to putting a crew together for the job. Being small, short hits, though, we may want all the rewards for ourselves, which makes them ideal to play solo, as lone wolf, or with bots. The success of every job depends on your play solo, as lone wolf, or with bots. The success of every job depends on your operatives.
Okay.
And in the crime time mode, you'll need to hire the right operatives for the best results. We have a roster.
This guy comes with three rocks.
We have random ass stats, perks, and weapons.
It actually was three rocks. It was a stone that you can throw as a distraction. A great distraction tool. Simple, effective, improved by ages.
Stats, perks, and weapons. These guys will always be at your disposal. We also have our unique teammates, who will gradually become unlocked in the other game modes as you progress. These individuals have particular skill sets,
Tuna,
as well as more powerful and specialized weapons, and you will need them if you stand any chance of success. At the moment, we will keep them as a surprise and just show our classic teammates in action. All teammates need to be recruited, mostly with cold hard cash, but there are always some who will do it for the thrill of the job and cost nothing. Since we do not currently have any money from previous heists, we will start with them. For something more challenging, we can put out contracts for more complex jobs. Planning these also takes cash, because you are going to want to attract the very best operatives to help you. Medium-sized jobs are always worth hiring the right team, so in this case, it's worth inviting others in co-op play.
The big at least have co-op, okay.
But can only be unlocked once you have proven yourself in Baker's Battle, or by completing it in someone's hosted session. Checking the server browser to join a co-op session is always worth doing. You may get to play locked contracts.
10,000 ping, huh? Assets. No, I'm okay.
The goal of this mode is quick fun and earned cash. Cash is used to buy better weapons, recruit more associates, bail them out, and or assist in their recovery via medical intervention. As you can see, the crime time mode is a fast-paced pick-up-and-play hit of criminal fun. It combines everything.
A pick-up-and-play hit of criminal fun.
Into bite-sized, adrenaline-fueled action. And, speaking of the main game, we move on to Baker's Battle, the bulk of the game, which will require all your skill and cunning to master. Baker's Battle is the ultimate single-player experience of Crime Boss, where players get to take on the role of Travis Baker, played, of course, by Michael Madsen. You are always competing against and trying to stay one step ahead of Sheriff Norris, who runs Rocky's law enforcement. He will always be collecting evidence against you.
So I love that Chuck Norris's name is just Chuck Norris.
Mess the job up, and he will zero in on you very quickly.
Everyone else has like aliases or different names. Fucking Sheriff Norris.
I can see it. Why did I beat you this time?
The harder you try and the more attempts you give it, the better you will get. You will accumulate boss points to level up and start putting some distance in between yourself and Norris. The ultimate goal of Baker's Battle is to become the king of Rocky's underworld, which means systemically gaining control over all the turf in the city, one job at a time.
One pile of bodies at a time.
Dollar Dragon, played by Danny Trejo, the Gang of Yellow, played by Vanilla Ice, an Asian warlord, and an Italian mafioso. A full suite of factions determined.
I will accept Danny Trejo's mob boss name being the Dragon.
His friend and Captain Touchdown, played by Michael Rooker, who commands an army of thugs to do your bidding. And of course, you will need someone to manage your finances, as conducting a turf war.
There's no beating this game, apparently. Obviously not. Not if the sheriff's Chuck Norris.
And will advise you on where to spend your resources. The best way to earn money is, of course, through criminal activity. Robberies, theft, heist, whatever opportunities present themselves. And Nassara, that is me, by the way, and the likeness is uncanny, knows about opportunities and will help you manage the crew with the right stats, perks, and weapons. And last but certainly not least, we have Gloves, played by Danny Glover. As your inside man, he knows about the most valuable heist worth preparing for. These will take effort, and only the best crews will do for the jobs Gloves presents you with. The big heists are difficult, and the risk is high, especially if Baker personally takes part in the heist. Permadeath is real. Do not worry, though. In Rock A, everyone gets a second chance. So on your next playthrough, you might just get it right. However, in this fast-moving metropolis, you will inevitably find that...
Permadeath is real. You might get it right on your next playthrough. Fucking what? Heists
...and different random events. No one will ever experience the same game twice. It's going to take many attempts and a true criminal mastermind to dominate Rocky...
Is this a roguelike? I don't know.
We cannot wait for you to experience the campaign once we launch. And now, we are coming to the third and final part of Crime Boss.
Yeah?
Urban Legends mode.
The Urban Legends mode is pure 90s action. It is packed with Hollywood stars and high-stakes heist, and we have had a blast.
Who paid for this?
In the Urban Legends mode, you can play through 6 short mini-campaigns, and each campaign consists of 3 missions that must be played consecutively, each getting progressively tougher. You will have 4 unique teammates to play with, and an additional 2 as backup. You can choose any of them to play solo or with bots, or call your friends online to join in co-op.
Pretty sure Rockstar paid for this. Is that who the developer is? Publisher? Did we see?
Where you unlock the unique teammates for crime time mode mentioned earlier. Okay, that's enough briefing for me.
So here's the problem, right? We want to say thank you again. The concept of everything that they've laid out in this game, the game modes, the like game loop, everything would be actually pretty sick if the actual game didn't look like garbage. So, okay, it was published by 505 Games and developed by InGame Studios. Doesn't mean anything to me. By the way, it is not on Steam. This is on the Epic Game Store. It's $40 and is on sale. The base game is on sale for 20% off for $32. So again, I will say again, everything they showed off, like the little mission board that kind of made me think of like Warhammer 40K Darktide, the story mode of trying to overtake the city, that's pretty cool. Co-op missions that are like specially built to be co-op missions, also cool. But the problem is that just the game itself doesn't look very good. The shooting looks really rigid and like not very fluid. It doesn't look very it doesn't look like it's going to control very well. And I feel like a lot of the budget went into these faces that you're seeing on this artwork right here rather than making the game good. Anyway, so that's Crime Boss Rocket City. It's basically out now. If you're interested in checking it out, it looks like it is exclusive mostly to the place, to the Xbox, to the Epic Store. Although I do see down in the bottom here, there's mention of the PlayStation Family, PlayStation 5, and PlayStation 4 logo, but I don't see anything about Xbox at this point. So I don't know what all it's going to be coming to necessarily. The only thing on here is the Epic Game Store. Boy, howdy. Okay, I thought I was lost and confused when they showed off the initial trailer at the Game Awards, and I'm less confused, but still lost. So let me know what your thoughts are. Put them down in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you. If you're excited about this game, why? And I don't just mean that as a joke. I would actually like to know why. Otherwise, if you want to keep up the conversation elsewhere, two great places to do so are Discord and Twitter. Speaking of Discord, we have a channel dedicated to these reactions where you can place links of your own that we can check out together live on stream, because we do stream on Twitch, and I would love to see you there. If you enjoyed this video, please leave it a like. If you want to catch future videos, please subscribe to the channel to go watch one of the other videos on the channel, or if I see you in the live stream, thank you and enjoy. It's a journey I didn't know we were going on. Are you all okay? I'm okay, I think. I need to change hats. Oh. Let me go ahead and change shirts real quick too, hang on. First placement in the next battle will be your last. I should head to bed. Very well, Canadiano. Thank you so much for hanging out and chatting and placing and stuff. 200 gold. It can be yours for 420 channel points. Most kills going to El Canadiano. Most assists to AP10. Give the money again to Athena. You got it. Whew.
Am I only the only person who thinks Michael Rooker is handsome? I mean, I am not personally attracted to him, but I won't judge you for being attracted to him. Wait. I think we auto win this. I don't see a target. No targets above their heads, and there's no other enemies. I think we auto win as just a heads up on this one. I could be wrong, though. That was... I think that fits my fun little statistic fact. If you are part of the 1% of the 99% of the world who's attracted to Michael Rooker, that's still 75 million people. Sam goes, what is your taste in men? I'm so confused because you don't have to like a specific taste. What? I mean, I think the question that's being asked is like, what is your type necessarily? Yeah. All right. So we're gonna do the reaction to Terra Nil, and then we're going to transition into the conversation about video game remakes and the Game of the Year awards. Hi. Every man of data have been completely different. I mean, you know. I don't think it matters to anyone but you, as long as you are attracted to the people that you are with. All right. I've committed another Steamtrocity and bought RE4 Remake. If there's any Steamtrocity that you're going to make, that's a good one. All right, everyone, put in your YouTube swans, your Pog swans, your re-swans, or any other emote that fits your fancy. You know, any other emote that fits your taste in emotes. It can be from my channel, your channel, or anyone else's. It does not matter. What's wrong, France? Okay. Here we go. Greetings and salutations. My name is Michael Schwann, and today we're checking out Terra Nil. Now, we checked out Terra Nil a while back, and it was just such a lovely, cozy experience where you are kind of terraforming a land. It was really beautiful and looked really, really relaxing. It's actually finally approaching release. At least I think it's going into early access on March 28th. We're not going to be rewatching anything else that we watched previously, so we're going to be jumping into the middle of their marketing, but I do have 5 trailers here of the marketing that has been out since our last video. So we're going to go back to November 3rd of 2022 and work our way forward from there. So I will let the game speak for itself.
Hi, I'm Jonathan Hao-Yoon. I work at a studio in Cape Town, South Africa called Free Lives. I'm the art lead on a game called Terra Nil.
See, look how pretty that is. You remember this? Definitely interesting because it's pretty and penguins. Yeah, it looks just so pleasant.
Terra Nil is coming to Steam in early 2023, as well as a simultaneous launch on mobile with Netflix games.
Oh, interesting. It's going to be on phones? That's neat. This is from a month ago on February 13th. Pretty and penguins, count me in. Welcome in, Herr Fuchsig. Oh, that was cool. Big old drill to bore out a river. Frogs. Frog. Some deer. Like, the art direction in this game is just so lovely. Like, it's just pleasant to look at. It's like it would be a really fantastic screensaver. That just when you look over, it just kind of makes you smile and feel good. Frog! Athena, where'd you get that frog emote? Is that just a native to Twitch frog? It is! Oh my god. Okay. Like, I don't think that there's necessarily a lose or a fail state to this game. I think you just make the land pretty and try to, like, fill up, like, an agriculture bar of, like, did you make enough green stuff and stuff so that the ecosystem can survive on its own? Well, time to go. We're going to go find another land that needs to be terraformed so that it can be a thriving ecosystem with crabs and flamingos. And turtles. And jellyfish. Look out, jellyfish. The turtle will eat you. Liquid hot magma. Well, that's pretty. Yeah, this is looking very save the world via friendly, wonderful ecosystems, right? It's like, okay, how are we going to save the world? Well, the world's in a shabby state, so what if we just regrew everything? Or it all burned down. I don't know if that was supposed to happen that way. Oh, no. Do we want... It's snowing. DLC shall be pet the animals. Can you pet the dog? Maybe. I don't know if humans exist. Like, presumably somebody is piloting that spacecraft, but it might not be us. It might not be humans is what I meant by us. Want to be able to interact with all the animals and marine life? It'd be cool if you could, like, click on them and stuff, right? Like, if you tapped on them or clicked on them, if they would respond, like, jump up with, like, an animation or something. Like, it doesn't have to be hyper complex, just, like, a way to acknowledge one another's existence. Click on a stingray and they do a little swim swirl thing. Yeah. What is that? Oh. Well then. Okay, we still have more. So this is the PC and Netflix trailer from February 20th. What is that? A rocket. Like, the soft sound of, like, the... Like, if this is just straight gameplay, obviously I expect the HUD is probably there. But, like, the soft music, and then you can hear, like, the water and the leaves and the wind and stuff. This is super chill, right? Stuff growing. Like, it's like an ASMR game. You can't lose. You might be able to lose. I don't actually know. You can't lose. You got these wonderful, chill, like, just super calming tones. You're just making stuff pretty. It all sounds so pleasant in your ears. Sounds great in my monitors. Yeah, just so pleasant. A beginner's guide to ecosystem restoration. Here's probably an actual explanation of how gameplay works.
A beginner's guide to ecosystem restoration.
Frog.
This video will serve as a general guide to the intricate process of restoring an environment from a wasteland to a thriving ecosystem.
Well, there is evidence of humans, there is
the first step in any destroyed restoration building. Endeavor is to bring back water and plant life. No matter what environment you're in, you'll need to generate electricity from the natural power around you. Now,
Use toxin scrubbers to cleanse the soil and sea. Pumps and irrigators get clean water everywhere it needs to go, allowing the natural greenery to grow. Alteration of the terrain is often an essential part of the process. Once the backbone of the ecosystem is thriving, your next step is to increase the diversity of plant life. Foster the conditions under which vibrant and unique habitats develop. Whether
Ready.
By upgrading your buildings, manipulating the climate, or by other more circuitous means. Introduce fauna by scanning the area for the conditions that each species requires.
But at least there's beaver. And parrots. An elk. That big elk.
With plant life and climate re-established, your final step is to construct an airship by recycling your buildings.
Leave no trace. Or at least as small of a trace as possible.
Buildings packed up. It's time to move on. Or to appreciate what you've helped to create.
Fun. You just fly around for a moment. Penguins.
Restoration. Terranil, available March 28th.
Well, you have a lovely voice. Thank you for that. Okay, and then the last one is we have What the Facts, Terranil by Free Lives. And this is from just yesterday, March 25th. So,
developed by Free Lives, Terranil is a resource management puzzle game with a focus on environmental rehabilitation. Spanning four unique regions, each with its own distinct tools and challenges. You are tasked with reintroducing water, life, and biodiversity to each of them. Then, you recycle your gear and move on. This game of wasteland restoration is slow-paced, meditative, and challenging. Enjoy the peaceful ambiance of nature and the soothing soundtrack as you play.
Then go take a nap.
But don't be surprised if you find yourself restarting from a recent checkpoint.
Oops, messed it up.
Played with either a mouse and keyboard or via touchscreen, Terranil will take most players between 4 to 6 hours to play through.
Thank you.
Three difficulty levels and additional unlockable biome challenges.
I really appreciate when they tell you how long the game is.
2023 on PC, as well as iOS and Android devices for Netflix subscribers.
All right, so that's Terranil. Is it already available? Yeah, it is available for pre-purchase. The game is going to be $25, at least on Steam. It doesn't sound like you can purchase it on phones. It sounds like you have to be a Netflix subscriber, and then you go through. I don't know how that works. But anyway, so that's Terranil. On Steam, it's tagged as a nature strategy relaxing city builder puzzle game. It is interesting that there is some sort of fail state. I'm not sure. Oh, you like my nails? Thank you, Herfuxing. I'm not sure what the fail states are. Like, maybe it might be that you can't necessarily fail, but you're like, man, trying to recover this is going to be difficult because I spread the lava too far, and I don't know if I have the resources to bring it back up. So I don't know. I almost would rather it not have that because it does feel like it is better marketed as a relaxing, just ASMR, chill, meditative puzzle game that isn't challenging. But I don't know. They can do what they want. It's their game. So that's Terranil. It's so chill. It's so pretty. It's so lovely to look at. I really hope that this game does well, just because I'd like to see more games like it, because it really is very charming. So that's Terranil. Let me know what your thoughts are. You can put them down in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you. If you want to keep up the conversation elsewhere, two great places to do so are Discord and Twitter. And speaking of Discord, we have a channel dedicated to these reactions where you can play things of your own that we can check out together live on stream. The announcement sounded like it's included for Netflix subscribers. Or is there an extra Netflix game subscription one has to pay? I bet it's just included with your regular Netflix subscription, but I don't know how you access games through Netflix. I don't know if you need to give the game, like, your Netflix information or what. But for the people that do want to play it on iOS and Android, I'm sure that it, like, you might be able to search it on the Apple Play Store, Apple Store or the Play Store, or maybe it goes through the Netflix app. I'm not entirely sure. There is a game session on Netflix. There you go. Thank you, Athena. Anyway, if you enjoyed this video, please leave it a like. If you want to catch future videos, please subscribe to the channel. Do go watch one of the other videos on the channel, or if I see you in the live stream, thank you and enjoy. All righty then. What? How much time do we have on this battle? We have 14 minutes. That's fine. So the next battle is going to be ran off to the side as just a heads up, because we do have three more games to react to, but I'm going to kick off what the next video is, which the next video is a conversation. And so let me get a couple of things open for that. Let me go like this, and let me open this and shrink it. I'm going to run it off to the side, so just know that when the battle is ready, I will run it, but it's going to be off to the side. And then let me go into here, and like into here, and into here, and go like that. Okay, make sure that looks fine. It does. And then let's get some music started. Why did you do that? Thank you. Back. So I need to get that game. You get that game, Star. It releases in like 2 days on Steam. All right. You can throw up a high YouTube video, a high Swan, Pog Swan, Reswan, whatever you want. If you want to just move the chat along just a little bit. I am going to choose. Let's get the right track. What would be the right track? Probably something Final Fantasy related. We can go with... Yeah, we'll go with this. Okay, so we need to have a conversation because the internet is having a conversation. And of course, as a privileged white man, I must inject myself into that conversation. And that is about the recent discussion over video game remakes and specifically their eligibility for awards within the video game space. Because we've really seen a really powerful set of video game remakes start to release in the last handful of years, as people have called for games of the past to be presented in the modern sense. And we've long wanted like ports of older games available on modern systems, and that's not necessarily what we're looking at. Ports are great. We love ports. It's good for a video game accessibility, especially if it's on PC and stuff like that, but that's not what we're here for. We're talking about major remakes, because 2023 has seen is seeing a lot of major remakes, some of which are very well received. The first one of which that I'm immediately aware of, at least according to my notes, is the Dead Space remake that released back in January. It was incredibly well received. It's sitting at like, who knows, 82, 89, 92 out of 100 on Metacritic. It's probably massively up there. We also just now got the Resident Evil 4 remake, which is sitting at a 92, I believe, on Metacritic. And it's a remake of what is hailed as one of the greatest games ever made, and is being very, very well received. And then we even have games like Advance Wars 1 and 2 Reboot Camp that are coming up soon as well. I believe this releases in April. We have the System Shock remake that releases at the end of April, at the end of May.
releases in just the next couple of months as well. And these are full-on remakes, but there's also a conversation to be had about really good remasters or really good modern ports, such as Like a Dragon Isshin that also released this year. We also had Metroid Prime Remastered released this year. And while it did update Metroid Prime for use with like modern controls and stuff like that, it is ultimately extremely well received and receiving lots of critical acclaim for, one, being a remake of a game that we already know and love, although it is a remaster more than a remake, but also the quality of life improvements that were added onto it. Risk of Rain Returns is approaching sometime in the near future. Risk of Rain 2 did extremely well for Hapu Games, so they're bringing the original title forward. And then we have Silent Hill 2 that is approaching being made by Bloober Team. That's the team that's behind the recent game, The Medium. And so we have all of these really major remakes, and I'm sure there's many more that I haven't mentioned, because if we go even in the past a little bit, we have the games like Demon's Souls Remake, remade by Blue Point Studios, and then like Link's Awakening, which was a complete rebuild of, I think Link's Awakening was a Game Boy game? I can't remember if it's a... I'm pretty sure it's a Game Boy game. I get it confused with like a Link to the Past and stuff. Like all those old 2D Zelda games, they all blur together in my mind. So we've got a lot of really good remasters and remakes and stuff that have come out or coming out. And the question is, what awards should these games be allowed to make? To win, okay? Because there is a very good chance that Resident Evil 4 Remake and the Dead Space Remake will get nominated for 2023's Game of the Year. Now, that said, they will have to contend with Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom, which I believe a lot of people already expect to win Game of the Year, kind of like in 2022. People were like, it's probably Elden Ring. God of War might get it, but it's probably Elden Ring. And it ended up being Elden Ring, right? And so the question arises of, does recreating something that was previously already a hallmark success, a critically acclaimed title, deserve the same acclaim and accreditation as original IPs, or does it need to be separate? And in previous years, like IGN had a remasters and remake category, but there's multiple categories in the awards shows. Because you can, it's kind of like God of War lost the Game of the Year category, but it won the Action Adventure category. And then you also have Best Direction and Best Soundtrack, and then you get into also individual genres. Like there was Best Action Game, which Bayonetta 3 won, and then you have Best RPG, and you can be in multiple of these categories. But should remakes be eligible for Game of the Year? Now, before I share my specific thoughts on it, there's two specific remakes that we need to talk about. The first one is Resident Evil 2, often called one of the best remakes ever. It's really what kind of kicked off Capcom's new resurgence over the last 5 years of just them being a juggernaut. It was kind of, I believe it was the debut of the RE engine that they use in all of their titles today. And Resident Evil 2 Remake was nominated for a ton of stuff. Now remember that a lot of people talk about the Game Awards, but there's other major award shows as well. There's the Golden Joystick Awards, there's the DICE Awards, there's the BAFTA Awards, and all of these are also very prestigious events when it comes to video game accreditations. And so when it came to Resident Evil 2, some of the things that it won Ultimate Game of the Year at the Golden Joystick Awards. It was nominated for Game of the Year in 2019, but it lost to Sekiro Shadows Die Twice. It was also nominated for Best Game Direction, Best Audio Design, Best Action Adventure Game. At the 23rd Annual DICE Awards, it was nominated for Adventure Game of the Year, Outstanding Achievement in Audio Design, Outstanding Achievement in Art Direction. It was nominated for a lot, and it did actually pick up one Game of the Year award at the Golden Joysticks. It is still heralded heavily as a beloved title. The other one, which Resident Evil 2 was a very, very faithful recreation of Resident Evil 2. Final Fantasy VII Remake, being probably one of the largest, most substantial remade games ever at this point, and it was only a small portion of Final Fantasy VII. It also got nominated and won several categories. So it was nominated in the Golden Joystick Awards for PlayStation Game of the Year, Best Visual Design. At the Game Awards 2020, it was also nominated for Game of the Year, did not win. It was nominated for Game Direction, Narrative, Art Direction, Best Score in Music, and Best Role-Playing Game. It won both of those last two. It also won Role-Playing Game of the Year at the 24th Annual DICE Awards. It has been nominated for a absolute pile of stuff. So let's see real quick what other people have already said. So yes, and only if they redo the actual gameplay style, like Final Fantasy VII or Demon's Souls personally. But wasn't Demon's Souls pretty faithful? I mean, I know they opened it up to like essentially omnidirectional instead of four directional. But it was pretty faithful, at least from what I saw a lot of people saying on it. I personally don't like the new take on gameplay for Final Fantasy VII, but I see that it was generally well received. Final Fantasy will always have a debate over its combat systems. I was saying about the quality of the new gameplay, but it was different from the original. Oh, okay. I still disagree that Final Fantasy is a role-playing game. I mean, that's a slightly different conversation, but it regardless of it being a role-playing game, for the sake of it being a remake, it definitely was. It follows the original game very closely, but Final Fantasy VII also presents a conversation about it not actually being necessarily a true remake in the way that Resident Evil 2 was. Resident Evil 2 tries very hard to be as close as it can be to one for one, where Final Fantasy VII Remake from the very beginning said, no, we're not doing one for one, and in some ways it almost feels like a sequel. So, but the question also arises from things like DLC, director's cuts, and complete editions, one of the largest of which is probably going to be Persona 5 Royal. So Persona 5, the base title, released in 2015/2016, depending on where you are in the world, and it won a ton of awards and nominations when it released. All of the Persona titles, well, at least Persona 3, 4, and 5, they have a director's cut where it's still the same game, but there's just a lot more added on to it. Additional, like, dungeons and characters and social links and stuff like that, and sometimes new or an improved mechanics. And Persona 5's was Persona 5 Royal. And it released in 2019/2020, depending on where you were in the world. And Royal was awarded and nominated for its own awards, and it even won some of the awards that it was nominated for. And that is an interesting thing as well, because unlike a remake, Persona 5 Royal isn't even being a remaster. It is just a director's cut. It is just extra being added in. And to take that even farther, you have The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt's DLC, Blood and Wine, which it is just DLC. You cannot play and buy Blood and Wine by itself. You must own the base game. And I'm not even sure if you can load directly into Blood and Wine, but I don't actually know on that part. However, the DLC for Witcher 3 at the Game Awards in 2016 was nominated for Best Role-Playing Game, and it won the category. It won Best Role-Playing Game at the Game Awards in 2016, and it is DLC. I really don't agree with that, I will say right now. Compared to the conversation about remasters and remakes, it is DLC. It is an expansion pack. I don't believe that that is a standalone title that should be considered alongside original or just even other remakes that exist out there. It is extra content. It's not even a standalone title. But beyond that, again, we have the upcoming Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, which, with the events that took place in Final Fantasy VII Remake, while they are still going to play through a lot of the core storyline to Final Fantasy VII, we know from Remake that they are making some changes. So, unlike Resident Evil 2, where it's pretty darn faithful, Remake and Rebirth, they are using the original game as kind of like outlines. Like, they're taking the plot points of Final Fantasy VII and going, okay, here's our outline, and then we're just going to make a bunch of our own stuff on the sides, and, you know, this path isn't going to be straight from here to here. We're going to go over here and twist and turn it around. So it follows the core story, but it does have some significant changes to the point that it doesn't even feel like a remake, and it instead is kind of like a reimagining. So does that put it in the same category as things like Resident Evil 2 Remake? I'm not sure, but it's an expansion, and much like other expansion, requires the base game. I like the approach that they took with Resident Evil 2 because it opened up the franchise. People have missed out on the original experience and just can't do that with old controls or old graphics anymore. Right, and then they also have, you know, like really high-end remakes. Like they did really, I don't know if it's necessarily a remake or a really high-quality remaster that they did of the first Resident Evil game, which name completely escapes me. And I didn't see that that game really had much accolades accredited towards it. And it's also a difference between like which award ceremony is going through, because there was some award ceremonies that I was looking at, like the nominations, and even in years where they had really good remakes like Resident Evil 2 or Final Fantasy 7, they did not earn a nomination. So where does that sit? Like, you know, maybe those locations have decided that, you know, we're not going to accept those games for these categories because they are remakes and you know, remasters and stuff like that. Like Destiny 2, many of its DLCs are expansions, but are also all their own experiences? Sort of, but you can't just fire those up. You have to have played through the original Destiny. Well, you don't have to have played it to like appreciate them, but you can't just start at the expansion. You have to go through like the onboarding process for the game. I did actually play some Destiny 2, so I can at least attest to that one, of that you can't just load straight into the new content. You will need to like get it, because Destiny is basically an MMO, right? So much like World of Warcraft or Final Fantasy 14, you can't just jump straight into Dragonflight or jump straight into Endwalker. You have to start up the game and get up to level and stuff. And sometimes the games have catch-up mechanics or ways for you to be able to skip forward in that way, but it isn't necessarily something that you can just say it's its own experience. They largely have their own beginning and end with maybe a thread that connects the expansions to one another, but they often at the same time are their own individual experiences, a story that begins and ends with that specific release. It's like good for them to win an award for the DLC, but also how is the award taken from a complete game? That's definitely how I feel specifically about Blood and Wine, and from what I could find, it definitely is one of the only instances where that happened. And I know that The Witcher 3 is a very beloved title, but that just feels wrong. It's one thing for a consideration to be made for these remasters and remakes. Two others that I'll point out, though, that raise this question even again is The Last of Us Part 1 Remake, which this one obviously is one of the more controversial remakes that have come out, because they did do a PlayStation 4 remastered version, and this game doesn't feel very old. Mind you, the original title, I believe, released in like 2013, so it was 9 to 10 years between the original release and now, and it was a PlayStation 3 title. And PlayStation 3 versus the remake, they definitely, you can tell just how much of a difference there is. Even comparing the remaster to the remake, they definitely put in a lot of effort to remaking this game. However, there's a rumor that Horizon Zero Dawn is getting a remake, a full remake, not like a touch-up, not like a next-gen port or anything like that where they add in some PlayStation 5 fast loading or anything like that. It is allegedly an entire remake of a game that I believe released in 2017. So that's not even that old, right? Like it's basically a current game. Like the sequel to this game, which looks very similar to the original, was a current gen title. Like Horizon Zero Dawn was one of the hallmark titles for PlayStation 4. It got a PlayStation 5 version essentially, and then Horizon Forbidden West, which uses a lot of the work from Horizon Zero Dawn, is a PlayStation 4/5 title on its base release. We don't actually know if this is necessarily actually a thing. And obviously, if we look at like Final Fantasy, Last of Us Part 1, sure, maybe there's something that you're doing to bring this forward. And I do think that with like The Last of Us Part 1, which had a HBO show that was very well received, the remake was more to have a new full-priced, full like gorgeous package offering for the people that'll be looking into the game after having watched the show, rather than necessarily the game needing a remake. It was to capitalize off the release of the show. I feel like I vaguely recall someone talking about there being a show for Horizon Zero Dawn, which would probably fit into the same reasoning for why they'd want a remake of it if there is a show that is going to be releasing, so that you can release the remake in tandem with the show. But personally, in a general sense, I don't have an issue with them being in the same category. And like I already mentioned, each award show is weird and different because these award shows all have like different qualifications for them, because there's, you'll see games that are like, I remember, what was it? It was Among Us. Among Us actually came out in 2016, but didn't get popular until like 2019, 2020 when the pandemic hit. And in those years, despite it being the same game that released years before, it was getting nominated and winning awards at major award ceremonies like the Game Awards. And I'm like, I understand this game got popular this year, but this game did not release this year. I don't feel like it deserves a spot on this accreditation. Like, that's where, like, best ongoing game, or, like, you could even create a category for, like, you know, most recent resurgence or something like that. Like, best comeback or something like that. Like, No Man's Sky could be in that category for, like, greatest comeback or Among Us and stuff like that. So, I agree it'd be brash, but this is also where you were at thinking about DLCs not being eligible for Game of the Year, winning some subcategories rather than being scooted off their own categories. Well, and that's the problem, is that there's not really a category for DLC. So, feels like a tightrope walk, and that it's a really hard line to define because of that. Because one of the other things is, a lot of these remakes, like even The Last of Us Part 1, they aren't necessarily a lower effort when it comes to the development and production of those games. And in a lot of circumstances, it might even be more effort than their original releases. Modern video game development is an immense undertaking that takes a substantial amount of people. There are some very incredible exceptions and examples of very successful games being developed by small teams or even a single individual, but those are the exception. Most games take a very substantial team, and most of the games that are making it into these categories as remakes that are going into like Game of the Year, they had hundreds, if not thousands of people working on them. And sure, some of the initial like foundational work, some of the pre-production work is already finished, like the script might be there or some really basic ideas of level design, but you still have to recreate everything. Like, sure, you didn't have to, you know, draw it out necessarily, although they probably still did storyboards and concept art. And in the events of like how some of these games play out, like Final Fantasy VII Remake, they definitely would have to do a lot of storyboarding for that, because it does have some, I don't want to say significant, but definitely substantial changes from the original game. And Resident Evil 2, I didn't play the original, but I imagine that with how high of a quality of a game that is, that there was still a very significant portion of pre-production that went into that game. So sure, you have a little bit of your like starter work done, but you still have to do everything. It's still a massive, massive game and a massive undertaking to complete. Rengen Clegg did that with its movie as well. Oh, the PlayStation 4 one? I've heard Netflix was making a Horizon Zero Dawn show. That's what it is. And that would make sense for why they would remake Horizon Zero Dawn, to try and capitalize on that show's hopeful success. So, was it released on PC or was it only mobile? I forgot that debate. Are you talking about Among Us? I think it was on both. Sure, the skeleton is there. Now time to actually create the meat. Yeah, and even the skeleton, it's like a stick figure. It's not even like a high-definition skeleton. You have the most basic platform to stand on. We need more categories, maybe? Well, I would agree that we need more categories, because I already feel like, with the amount of games that are released now, that it is difficult to define where some of these games should belong. Because, like, the action-adventure category at most award shows, what's an action-adventure game? Like, sure, God of War got nominated, and sure, I could call that an action-adventure game, but so's Legend of Zelda, you know? And, like, almost any game that isn't, like, a puzzle platformer or like a rhythm game or a visual novel could probably be argued to be an action-adventure game. Especially because the Game Awards has action-adventure and action. And like Bayonetta, I would happily call that an action-adventure game. It was not nominated for action-adventure. It was nominated for action. And like God of War was nominated in action-adventure, but was not nominated for action. And I'm not sure where that line sits. It's kind of like the Oscars, the Academy Awards. Freaking comedy and drama. No, comedy and musical are in the same category. So you have Liar Liar and Les Mis going up against one another. Not literally, like those movies are very, very far apart from one another. But they would be in the same category, which does not make sense to me in the slightest. Didn't you already get exasperated when you did your pick'ems with all its categories? Let's not forget them giving away awards in the pre-show. Yeah, I mean, how the award shows are conducted is another thing. But with the award shows, I do think that there needs to be more categories, and the categories need to be easier to define, because so many of these titles feel like they are shoehorned in into categories that they don't necessarily belong. And at the same time, when it comes to whether a remaster or a remake is eligible for these major awards, with the amount of work that most of them take, I do think that they are eligible, because it's not a simple process. Like, I think that goes into the conversation of, like, what's a port versus a remaster versus a remake? Because, like, we had Tales of Symphonia released on modern consoles, like, this month or last month. And Tales of Symphonia was a port. It was not a remaster. It was definitely just a port. But then you have like Metroid Prime Remastered, to where they definitely overhauled it. They definitely had to rebuild some of the assets, and they added a modern control scheme into it. So that's definitely like a remastering of the game. And it took a team to do it, and not a small team either. And I think that we will see Metroid Prime Remastered be nominated for something at the end of the year awards this year. And then you have games like Final Fantasy VII Crisis Core Reunion, which it kind of falls in this weird area between remaster and remake, because so many of those assets were completely remade wholly, and environments had completely new assets generated, built, and placed inside of them, but they were able to use like their animation skeletons and the level design. And I don't just mean like the level layout, like they were able to lay their modern assets and textures in their old maps. They were able to use their previous maps without needing to recreate the levels. They could just lay new textures on them and add new assets and place new assets inside of them. So it was like somewhere in between a remaster and then a remake. And then of course you have games like Final Fantasy VII Remake and Resident Evil 2 Remake and 3 and 4 Remake that wholly from the ground up we had to rebuild absolutely everything, because the previous games are so old, right, that you're not really using anything of them besides reference work. And I think that there is probably a line somewhere, probably somewhere between port and remaster, that is kind of the cutoff of where something should be considered at. And I think that that is where it's up to the award ceremonies probably to determine that. And also, you know, the award ceremonies, they're going to do whatever they want anyway. But with the amount of work and effort that puts in, also, here's the other thing, right? Here's the other thing that we need to just admit to ourselves. If Resident Evil 4 is the best game that came out this year, that means that it was the best game of the year. Like, sure, did they use the model of a previously critically acclaimed game? Yes, but that also means that there wasn't a game that came out that was better than it, right? If Resident Evil 2 Remake would have won Game of the Year, it didn't. Sekiro Shadows Die Twice won, because the vote said that Sekiro Shadows Die Twice was better than recreating a previously beloved title. And so if at the end of the year we see the game that have come out that year and there just isn't something that is better than remaking something from 2003, 2006, whenever it was that Resident Evil 4 came out. I think it was 2003, actually. If there's just not something better than that, then that is a that is not necessarily a testament to how good Resident Evil 4 is. That is also saying, like, hey, we didn't have something that was able to contend with it that came out. I do think that Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom, if it does hold up, I know there's a lot of questions about that game in terms of, like, what it's actually going to be. But I think that if Resident Evil 4 Remake isn't able to take on Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom, or vice versa, then that's something to be said, right? Like, if remaking a game is better than what people are thinking of on their own, then maybe the original works need to put more effort into it. And I don't necessarily always think it's about money, although that does play a part in it, but you can also take heavy inspiration from something and just not have it be titled Resident Evil 2 Remake, right? Like, we played Signalis last year, and Signalis was definitely very, very heavily inspired by Resident Evil on, like, PlayStation 1, right? A lot of very similar vibes, tone, mechanics, and stuff. And that game was fantastic. And I had it on, like, some of the best games that I had played that year. And it wasn't called Resident Evil, but I would have believed you if you said that it was. Like, I could have seen where they could have put Resident Evil on there. It wasn't made by Capcom. It was made by an independent studio. But definitely the inspiration was there. And so I think that Signalis was a fantastic experience, an incredible game, and very deserving of a lot of the awards that it won. But there were games that the award ceremonies felt were better than it. So it didn't always win the awards that it was nominated in. It wasn't nominated for some of the categories that I thought it should have been nominated for. But that's where a difference of opinions comes in. I feel like the remakes and remasters of last year set a course. I think that we are in a very interesting position right now of being sold our nostalgia, of being sold our childhoods. With games like Resident Evil 2 through 4 Remake, Final Fantasy 7 Remake, there's a very large window right now, a very large window of opportunity for these studios to make remasters and remakes of previously beloved titles. And they are a source of not necessarily guaranteed, but very secure income and revenue. And that's why we're seeing so many of them be brought forward. Also, with modern consoles, a lot of these modern consoles, I say this as the Nintendo 3DS and Wii U shop are being closed, a lot of these modern consoles, it's easier to keep these games alive through the generations. Because PlayStation 5 is fully backwards compatible with PlayStation 4, and I expect that the PlayStation 6 will be able to play PlayStation 4 games, because we've reached the point where modern consoles are basically just proprietary computers. PlayStation 3 was not. It had a very specific system inside. The Cell engine was a nightmare to develop for, and every iteration of the consoles back then were during the explosive growth of technology, and everything was wildly different from the console before it because of its capabilities, its power, the way that it rendered graphics on the screen, whereas the PlayStation 4 is just a computer. The PlayStation 5 is just a computer. The Xbox One, Xbox Series X is literally a computer with just a proprietary operating system on it. It is made out of computer parts, and it has a dedicated set of software for it. It's not even very specialized. Like, when you open up the Xbox Series X, you can just see normal-ass computer parts just shoved into the box, okay? So, with these consoles operating so much like new computers do, it means that games that are released on these new platforms have a lot longer lifespan because they will be available for the next generation and hopefully the generations after that. And I think when these developers are realizing that their games will have a lot larger chance of immortality, it makes it easier to justify bringing these consoles forward, these games forward, because it means that they will be a source of legacy income as people pick up those legacy games as they go on sale, or a new version of the game comes, a new title in the franchise comes out and people want to see what else is available. So, you know, when Final Fantasy 16 comes out, you will probably see people go and purchase games like Final Fantasy 15, and Final Fantasy 7 Remake, Enjoy. that will, because those titles will be available on those platforms, and so you will have an increase in previous game sales due to the interest generated out of the newest game sales. And you haven't always been able to have that because games have been locked on older storefronts and stuff like that. So I think personally, I don't have a problem with them being open in these categories. I do think that if they are worthy of it, games like Dead Space Remake and Resident Evil 4 Remake should absolutely be eligible for Game of the Year against original releases. I mean, and we talked about Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom. While they haven't shown off very much of it, that game looks so much like they have just copy and pasted a ton of stuff from Breath of the Wild and said it's a new thing, and it's a sequel, kind of like Majora's Mask was to Ocarina of Time. But it's like, if you have reused so much of your previous work, should that be taken away from your eligibility as well? And no, I don't think that it should. And because all of this takes a lot of time, energy, and effort to do. But I can also understand where people would have an issue with it. I would like to see more game award categories, including maybe even a remasters and remakes category like IGN has. But then that raises the question of, will we have enough games in the year to be eligible for that category? Like this year, yeah, this year's looking absolutely fantastic, right? Like we already talked about Dead Space, Resident Evil 4, Advanced Wars, System Shock, and if you go into remasters, we talked about Like a Dragon, Isshin, Metroid Prime Remastered. Risk of Rain Returns and Silent Hill 2 aren't necessarily guaranteed to be out this year, but there's a lot of other remasters and remakes that are on their way. You got like Dragon Quest 3 is supposed to be out sometime soon, maybe, we hope. But it might mean that, like, you know, next year, maybe there's only like two major remasters or remakes. I doubt it, though, because I think these companies have learned that there's lots of money to be made in these remasters, remakes, and ports that are available to them. So I think that there's definitely room for a remasters and remakes category to be available at most of these award shows. But I don't know. Like Eve mentioned earlier, these award shows are really weird depending on which one you're watching. Because, like, the Game Awards, they handed out a ton of awards, like in the pre-show, or just rattled them off as lists and then just went back into the ads that are the video game trailers and stuff. So I think there's another discussion that could be had about that. Movies also go through the whole remake trend if done well, and I'm normally all for it. That's also true. And again, it doesn't take any less effort to remake the movie. The only thing that you really have for you is an outline. So that's where I'm at on remakes and remasters being eligible for Game of the Year or other awards categories. Let me know what your thoughts are if you haven't already. Seriously, let's have a conversation. Put your thoughts down in the comments below. If you want to keep up the conversation elsewhere, two great places to do so are Discord and Twitter. And I would love to just continue the conversation on any of those places. There's links to those platforms down below as well. We live streamed this entire conversation on Twitch. That's where we've had the chat and had this kind of exchange and back and forth about how we feel about different things and different categories. And if you want to be part of the next one, we do stream on Twitch, link down below as well. If you enjoyed this video, please leave it a like. If you want to catch future videos, please subscribe to the channel. And if you watch one of the other videos on the channel, or if I see you in the live stream, thank you and enjoy. All right, that's done. Let me make this big again.
Make it bigger.
There we go. And let's get the next reaction up and running, shall we?
Peggy.
Calm down. Okay. Did I change shirts? Was I wearing Shaggy for Terra Nil? I think I was. Let me go change shirts.
Okay. Ravenbound, I thought it was Raven Dawn, which is also released. I mean, it might be. I think it's Raven Spawn, maybe? I don't know. All right, everyone, put in your YouTube swans, your Pog swans, your Ree swans, or whatever other emote fits your fancy. It can be from my channel, your channel, or anyone else's. All right. Here we go. Greetings and salutations. My name is Michael Schwann, and today we are checking out Ravenbound. Now, I'm curious to see what this looks like, because looking at the screenshots for it, we got kind of like this third-person Skyrim vibe going on, right? And there's some sort of card system going on here. But also, when I was opening these trailers, I noticed here, watch the launch trailer for Ravenbound to explore the lands and features of this upcoming open-world action roguelike game set in a Scandinavian land, which raises some questions for me. So, let's see. We'll start back at the initial exclusive announcement trailer from August of 2022. I think I'm getting pretty exhausted with this concept of roguelites. It's not for the weak. Most like roguelites and Metroidvanias are just overdone, I feel. But we know you're different. But who knows? Maybe you can impress me. Let's do it. Could see that. That's why it entrusted you to wield its power. Well, that's cool. Do we get to fly as a raven? Grow one life at a time. Oh man, the frame stutters on that. Especially when someone does it with so little innovation or difference. Yeah, I feel like there's way too many indie studios that their first project is a Metroidvania that just feels like a Metroidvania. It doesn't set itself apart in any way beyond like maybe having a unique art style. But Peggy, yeah. 16. At least give yourself something that is eye-catching, right?
Ravenbound is an action-packed open-world roguelite set in a deadly but beautiful fantasy realm inspired by Swedish folklore. It's being developed by a small and dedicated team here in Stockholm. When making an open-world roguelite, it's like taking a traditional roguelite, but you tear down the walls of the traditional rooms of the dungeon crawl and instead exposing the options and choices to players.
Okay.
The staple of Ravenbound and the roguelite genre is permadeath, so we've based a lot of our design around that. We have implemented a card system. It's used to create synergies in your run and to make builds that cater to your playstyle. But as you progress, your deck of cards and its power will grow, so you will always start off the next run slightly better off than the one before.
My name is Brooke, and I'm the lead combat designer on Ravenbound. The combat in Ravenbound is a fast-paced hack-and-slash melee roguelite. Something we put a lot
looks
of
a lot better than the first trailer.
Very reactive enemy AI. They are going to come at you and attack you relentlessly. For example,
I appreciate that they're all coming at me at once.
Turn into a dance where the AI is forcing you to move around, and you
have
to use
nice.
Your entire arsenal of dodge and guard to be able to defeat them. In contrast, the Tuftir attacks in hordes. When fighting them, it's all about managing their chaos with knockbacks, using dodge to spread the
wow, that's a lot.
Timing of the guard to knock them down all
so
at
glad
once.
They're not just waiting one
then
for one by one.
Massive troll who is slow and has big, wide, sweeping attacks. The key to defeating it is to read its attack animations to make sure you can choose the correct response to whatever pain they're trying to dish out.
In Ravenbound,
Swedish company? If they're based out of Stockholm, yeah.
Murder you horribly, and everything will go wrong. Since we designed around permadeath, we really wanted you to feel a sense of triumph when you win.
Hello, I am Josephine, a narrative designer on Ravenbound. We've taken our inspiration from the very core of Scandinavian folklore, the creatures that scares us from going too deep into the woods. When you look at folklore, it's essentially just stories that people tell each other of what they don't know or understand. It's not about mighty heroes or warrior gods. It's about how the world is dark and dangerous, and these stories work to both entertain and warn people. We wanted to bring that feeling into our fantasy world and make it about the people and their experiences and the dangers of straying from the path. The world of Avalt is a world of two ages existing side by side, the old and the new. In times of old, the gods were always present, the heroes were mighty, and the craftsmen made amazing things. But all of that.
Did they just throw something at God of War? I mean, maybe.
It's a world of struggle.
Maybe not intentionally.
The monsters have been twisted and have reclaimed the wilds.
Oh, that's horrifying.
Dangerous as people. Through the blessings of the Raven, you get access to a history that has been lost to the people of Avalt. You, the vessel, get the full picture of what the world was and what happened to its inhabitants.
We are really excited to talk about Ravenbound with you. You can find us on Discord or any other social media. Come talk to us.
So here's the question, and they might answer it. We still have three more trailers. We have the Monsters trailers, the release date reveal trailer, and the launch trailer, okay? So I did talk about some of my personal exhaustion when it comes to roguelites, but there's ways that you can do them well, okay? And I feel like a lot of them really live and die by the combat, because that's one of the things that's going to be, like, center forward of you're repeating this over and over again, right? But what is the end goal of them? Because, for example, some of the, like, we'll take, like, Dead Cells, for example. Dead Cells, really excellent combat, really excellent visuals, but you can beat it. You can win a run. You can get to the end and beat the final boss, and then the run ends because you've succeeded. And the thing that carries Dead Cells is largely its combat, because while it does have a story, the story could fit between my real nail and my fake fingernail, okay? It is so thin and barely there. But then on the alternative side, you have roguelites like Hades, where you can technically win a run if you get all the way to the end and beat the final boss of the run. And it encourages you to do that and try to do it multiple times. But Hades, while it does have very fantastic combat, one of the things that pushes itself forward is that it has a very significant narrative that is built around its roguelike design. So one of the things that I am missing with these initial trailers is the idea of, like, what are we doing and why? Like you said, though, you know, we're going in and we got these blessings of the Raven and we're taking down these folklore monsters, but what is the goal that we're striking out to achieve? What are we hoping to accomplish? And I just, by the names of these titles of these trailers, I don't feel like they're going to communicate that. We'll take a look at the Steam page at the end if they don't and see if it has any additional information. But this is the Monsters trailer.
Ravenbound is a combat-focused roguelite set in a huge open world. And it's a dangerous world, too, filled with corrupted entities that wish to end your quest to save Avalt.
Okay, we're trying to save stuff.
And these are the monsters of Ravenbound. The Huller are deadly creatures of the forest. In battle, the Crown Mother will try to trap you with a putrid gas, allowing its scions to freely lash at you with its whip-like fingers. Keep moving while you avoid the Crown Mother's attacks and wait for the right moment to strike. Draugr are the undead that lurk in the mists. The Draugr champion will summon warrior and barbarian Draugr to fight for it. But don't let these keep you from your target, as once the leader falls, the rest are laid to rest. Trolls are massive creatures that can kill just about anything unfortunate enough to meet the end of their clubs. Avoid the trolls' attack at all costs. Studying the trolls' huge movements will help players dodge and block their powerful
blows. Some sort of perfect block slash perfect counter there.
There are many more enemies you'll face in your quest to save Avalt from hatred. Even though you are unlikely to succeed in a single lifetime, fear not, for in Ravenbound, that which kills you makes you stronger.
Philo Battle looked pretty neat there, and the orange-silver getup of the player just looked like the old X-Wing uniform from Star Wars. That's a bit of a disconnect. This is the release day reveal trailer. I wonder if your runs, like as you unlock more cards and abilities and weapons and stuff, if that allows you to skip ahead, right? Because it wouldn't be nearly as like painful. Like one of the things that I didn't care about with Hades is because I really wanted to progress, but you largely go through the same initial paces every time with Hades. And it's like, I just want to see more, y'all. And we're doing these same initial areas a lot because we're dying because it's a roguelike and they expect you to die. But I wonder if this game, with the way that it unlocks additional power-ups, allows you to... Hi, buddy. You got a lovely smile. If it allows you to jump ahead. Like, you no longer... You've unlocked enough abilities that you don't need to go kill the goblins anymore. You can just jump... Oh, you can pass up the goblins because it is open world, right? You should be able to go largely wherever you want. So you're just trying to build up enough power and skill and ability and equipment to be able to take on, presumably, you know, the Void Gate or whatever. This is a launch trailer. It just came out a day or so ago. Hollywood smile, yep. It does have card mechanics, Herfluxig, but the card mechanics, they affect the way your run starts. They explained it in one of the earlier trailers that we watched. Let me get over to that. Here it is. So, like, these cards, like, you're going to start the run with the Shield of the Unwavering, and that increases your guard health and guard life by 50%. You're going to start with Bracers of the Deep Stone, it increases your armor by 15%. So this is the way that you gain progression, by starting out the run stronger with, like, effects, equipment, maybe spells, maybe abilities and stuff like that. So I wouldn't say that it's necessarily a card mechanic, necessarily. You're not going to be playing a card game against your enemies. It's just, it's kind of like your item slots, basically. I do think that they probably should have avoided calling these cards, because I do know that there are some people that they see cards and they just run away. Like, there are some people that just abhor card mechanics in the game. More like a startup randomizer, I guess. Well, you might be able to choose to take random cards. I think you get the cards from, like, beating bosses or dungeons. They didn't say that part, but I imagine that as you beat different challenges in the world, you earn new cards. And then you can probably choose random cards at the beginning, or you can try to handcraft a loadout to be able to progress farther or to fit your playstyle. But that's just a guess, obviously. I don't have much information beyond what we've already seen in these trailers, so... That's Ravenbound. Let's take a look at the Steam page real quick. It doesn't currently have a price listed on it. Permadeath and permanent progression. You're a vassal to the Raven. One vessel's life at a time. Each vessel is lost forever. The strength they bring to the Raven is not allowing you to come back each time. A unique fantasy open world inspired by Scandinavian... play your cards right to upgrade your builds. Progression comes in the form of the cards and unlocks you can find on your journey through a vault. Each lifetime, new cards are unlocked, some by chance and some by choice. As you grow stronger, so do the rewards. You'll be able to find cards that can grant everything from better armor to new playable classes, magical weapons, and relics that enhance your character, all with different synergies to discover. Finding the right combinations is a matter of life and death for a vessel. I want to know the end game of it. I want to know. But anyway, I mean, the game's going to be out. I'll probably see reviews and stuff for it, so then I'll be able to find out at that point in time. So that's Ravenbound. I am apprehensive. There are some things about it that I really like a lot, but every time I see a roguelite, I'm just immediately hesitant of, like, how much of my time are you going to waste for the sake of trying to create an extended gameplay experience due to having to start over? And it's not necessarily a criticism of this game, necessarily. It's a criticism of the genre. I feel like there are some roguelites that do it extremely well and others that just don't. And I think part of that is just really down to the base design of the game. So that's Ravenbound. Let me know what your thoughts are. I'd love to hear from you. Put it down in the comments below. If you want to keep up the conversation elsewhere, two great places to do so are Discord and Twitter. And speaking of Discord, we have a channel dedicated to these reactions where you can place links of your own that we can check out together live on stream, because we do stream on Twitch and I'd love to see you there. If you enjoyed this video, please leave it a like. If you want to catch future videos, please subscribe to the channel. Do watch one of the other videos on the channel, or if I see you in the live stream, thank you and enjoy. With Dead Cells, the entire endgame was just maxing your stuff and unlocking stuff, and it became extremely boring in the first finishing. In the first finishing, or you mean after the first finishing? Because, like, I can attest to that. Like, after I actually beat a run in Dead Cells, my interest in Dead Cells fell through the floor. Like, after I completed a run and then was able to complete, like, one or two more runs after that, I was like, oh, well, I think I'm done. I was like, I don't think I want to play anymore. Are these... those are assassins. Okay, let's go Killing Field, I think. Right out the door. And then, like, it can also really heavily depend on how the roguelite starts out your runs, because, like, another roguelite that I played a decent amount of was Enter the Gungeon, and I did like Enter the Gungeon, but one of the problems that I had with Enter the Gungeon, we're gonna die, was that the beginning of the runs in Enter the Gungeon felt terrible, and it always felt terrible. Once you'd gotten a little ways in and gotten a couple of upgrades and, like, some better weapons or whatever, it felt really good to play. But the beginning, felt bad. It felt bad to the point where you're just like, I just want to get far enough that it feels good again. And then you die, and then you're like, oh, I have to play the beginning again. You know, that's like, this sucks. My gun is slow and does no damage. I can mute it now. Thank you, Eve. Didn't want to do it to risk of it making sound earlier. I thought I had muted them, but good on you for waiting and checking. We died to die to everybody, so I'm going to place that. This is also going to be last now. So let me mark last. We have two reactions left to do. That's some... some tall letters. Oh yeah, we stretching these letters out. There we go. Alright. Last battle there. Two reactions left. We will do this one next. Athena, are you still lurking? Raven Dawn is an MMO coming out. Okay. You are? Okay. The reason I ask is because this is the one that I was talking to you about the other day. I need to change hats. Oh, yeah, and I am with Card Mechanics. I've never played more than 5 minutes of that one Kingdom Hearts game. Dream Drop Distance? Or is it Chain of Memories? It's one of those two. And I do play Magic the Gathering. Well, a tabletop card game, like, here's the thing. I played a shitload of Magic the Gathering, right? I was a tier one judge for Magic the Gathering. And when I tried to play, like, MTG Arena or MTGO before even MTG Arena was out, game's not as fun. Playing the exact same game on a screen versus sitting at a table, like, not the same. Not the same at all. I could never get into Modo or into Arena, and I played a crap load of MTG on tabletop. So, all right. Here we go. I'm the same with poker. That's fair. Digital poker sucks. Okay. Put in your YouTube swans, your Pog swans, your re-swans, or whatever else fits your fancy. And here we go. Get that out of there first. Greetings and salutations. My name is Michael Schwann, and today we are checking out Tainted Grail, The Fall of Avalon. With an asterisk on it, because we're going to be checking out something else just slightly first. So Tainted Grail, Fall of Avalon, I'm going to tell you right now, when I saw like a little bit of pictures here and there as I'm collecting these trailers up, because this game launches into early access in like a day or so, I was like, that just kind of looks like Skyrim. Is it Skyrim? I don't know. That's what we're going to be here to find out. But I also want to introduce the first game in the Tainted Grail franchise, just to kind of set the scene. These games are very, very different, as a heads up. But there is a game that is already out called Tainted Grail Conquest. It is available on at least Steam. I know it's on Steam. We're going to check out the announcement trailer and the launch trailer for Tainted Grail Conquest. I don't know how connected the games are, but just in case there's foundational like world stuff based on for the Fall of Avalon, I want to see Tainted Grail Conquest first, especially because I've only seen a little bit of Tainted Grail Conquest from my significant other playing it, because I believe it's available on Game Pass. So, first off, we will watch the announcement and launch trailer for Tainted Grail Conquest, starting now.
The Age of Red Death is over. The Age of Conquest has begun.
This game plays a kind of in the similar vein of Slay the Spire. Cards with a resource cost that you use to fight your enemies.
Every choice will matter.
And I do know that this game, it says it's a blend of RPG and roguelite. And what they mean by that is, like, you'll accept a quest as part of your run, and you will go out on the quest, and you'll, like, try to defeat an enemy, and if you defeat that enemy, you'll be able to, like, save somebody that then becomes part of your town or a new character that you can play as. So it does have a end game and a progression cycle in that way of that you're trying to complete this actual journey, essentially. So that was the announcement trailer. Here's the launch trailer.
Do you want to know? You will fall every single time. But then you will rise up again. Stronger, wiser, better prepared. Is it about having your wits about you? Is strength the key? The key is perseverance. After all, death is a process which you're about to conquer.
You enjoy this game, Athena? I'm glad to hear that. So like I mentioned, there is some story building and RPG aspects and progression within the world and the characters and the story that exists within this game. So if what we're getting ready to check out, which is a different style of game, because I understand that the game that you're looking at might not necessarily be something that you're like, oh yeah, I want to play that. But this game is a completely different genre, but it is in the same world and setting as what we just checked out. So if this game, it doesn't look appealing, but that game did, maybe go check that one out. If that game doesn't look appealing, maybe this one will. So now we're going to go into the initial teaser trailer for Tainted Grail, The Fall of Avalon that was posted on December 21st, 2021. Oh, hell no. Absolutely not. Never mind. I'm turning the video off. Okay, that was just a teaser trailer. Don't worry, we got more. So this is the official cinematic trailer. It's not going to show you gameplay. But, you know, I go in the order that the trailers were posted, okay? So this is from July 13th of 2022. Bit worried by the first one. Now I'm curious. You had my curiosity, and now I'm leaving with those child eyes. No. No, 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 no.
Table and its noble protectors. The majestic lake and its pure lady. One sword.
Looks like it sucks to be that guy. You look cold. I'm cold just looking at you.
Broke the laws of nature. Now we have to pay the price and clean up your mess. Hear me, Arthur. I do what I do, not out of duty, but out of wrath.
Oh, that's a nope door. Nope. You brought a single fucking longsword to kill that? That dude's dead.
To meet you.
Yeah, this guy laying on the ground underneath all these stupid annotation shits, that's that dude. That big horrible monster grabbed him, picked the sword out of his hand, held him down, and stabbed him with it and said, try again next time, fool. The hell? I showed up with a fucking longsword and nothing else against that abhorrent Cronenberg gross nasty. All right, anyway, here's a gameplay trailer from August of 2022. Wow, this is crazy looking. What is happening?
You're awake. Good.
Hi.
I thought I'd get us a fire burning. Would have been a shame to freeze to death when we got so far.
Very Skyrim-esque, yes. I love the environment design. Oh, dude, this looks bad for you. Oh, never mind, they're all dead. Yeah, the world design, I'm digging. I'm digging hardcore.
Or what was left of him. Merged him with his horse, don't you think?
Okay. Next, we have the official story trailer. This was from January 31st, 2023. We have one more after this, which is the early access release date. I just wish it didn't look graphically like Skyrim. Yeah, I mean, generic fantasy looks like generic fantasy. Hang on.
He started the Age of Conquest and took the island from the Foredwellers. Using the mysterious powers of Menhirs, together with Merlin, they cleansed the land of the weirdness, a primordial force of chaos and possibility. But now, long after the death of the king, Camelot is in shambles as Avalon fractures into chaos. Old legends are gone, and the weirdness is creeping back into our lands. The bleeding heart of the plague has started beating once more. And the Red Death has returned. Rulers of the Island Asylum, an order of the Red Priests, are desperate to stop it. By any means necessary.
Interesting. So Tintagel Conquest probably covers the events of King Arthur and Merlin's landing in Avalon and conquesting Avalon. And this is about 600 years or so later, maybe a bit less, when the evil forces that they pushed out have started to resurface. And of course, you know, it's been 500 or however many years. So Arthur and Merlin are long since gone. Let me see, I meant like looking like it was 2011. You know, I am actually, I've reached a point in gaming where unless something just genuinely looks terrible, and we've seen some games that genuinely look terrible doing these reactions, I don't care. Like if a game, if as long as it has a cohesive art direction and art style, if the game looks like a PlayStation 3 game, doesn't bother me, I don't care. If the game still like is designed in a way where it all feels like it is all meant to be together, like if it all still fits, as long as you don't have like a really nice looking model against like a bunch of really bad looking environments, I don't care, right? That's perfectly fine by me. Or and then the main question is the gameplay good? Is the story serviceable? Like those types of questions. I have no qualms with games that don't look like current gen games. Like the two games of the same franchise that came out in the last handful of years is like Bayonetta 3 and Bayonetta Origins. They both have either slightly dated looking graphics or a very unique art style in terms of Bayonetta Origins. And I loved them both because they were cohesive experiences that looked well, played well, and were an enjoyable time to get through. So, all right, this is the early access release date trailer.
Open yourself.
What do you want from us?
To take the Excalibur, obviously.
I actually think a lot of these, this just looks really good. The combat looks a little too close to Skyrim, and Skyrim's melee combat is trash. But the actual graphical presentation I like a lot.
The only thing it can bring is misery.
Why are you here?
I need you to kill King Arthur.
Didn't one of the other trailers say that King Arthur was dead? Okay, so one of the notes also is it is early access. It is not available for purchase at this time. There is a demo apparently available for it. Let's see if they say anything about how long. Early access, we're aiming for a period of 9 to 16 months, depending on player feedback and general developmental flow. So plan on 2 years, okay? It's very rare that these targets are ever made. That's not a bad thing. It's just something that you should be aware of, is that it's probably going to be longer than 9 to 16 months. Although I will be curious if this game makes its way to Game Pass, right? Tainted Grail Fall of Avalon is an incredibly ambitious project. Our goal is to create a living and breathing open world RPG with a lot of soul. We are an indie studio with a small roughly 30 person team, but we are highly ambitious and we want to create this unique game together with a community. We believe that involving players at an early stage of the game can be a fun experience for players and highly beneficial for the game's development because it gives us money. They didn't say that last part, but that's definitely probably what they're shooting for. The current early access version features the first chapter of the game, Horns of the South. It has around 10 to 15 hours of content, with more chapters to be added throughout the early access period. Please note that your saves may be deleted with major patches. 90% of the game's mechanics are present, but without final polish. There may be some bugs and imbalances. The final version of the game will have a more visual and audio polish on all fronts. The story quests from Chapter 1 are mostly finished, but may be altered based on player feedback. Okay. They expect the price to be higher at full release, so buying during early access should get you a pretty decent deal. Okay. So there is the presentation for Tainted Grail Fall of Avalon. I actually like a lot of what it's showing off so far. I completely understand you not being interested for the sake of early access, Eve. Like, I know that early access has burned a lot of people. I personally still don't have an issue with it. Depending on how it's presented, right? Because, like, one of the biggest, like, qualms that I would have was this statement about that your saves may be deleted with major patches. That's why I've been my biggest issue with Baldur's Gate 3 and why I refuse to touch that game until it's out. But Baldur's Gate 3, I also refuse to accept that because I don't feel like that is how Baldur's Gate 3 should have been presented, especially because I feel like that is a mistake on the side of Larian Studios, who did a fantastic job with Divinity Original Sin 1 and 2, and I don't feel like that should have been the approach that they had for Baldur's Gate 3. But with this, it actually bothers me a little less because it is kind of open-worldy. This is something that I would probably be willing to pick up and play around with initially, provide some feedback, and then probably not be willing to touch it until it's closer to completion. And I know that they'd want people to continue playing, like, through the early access period, but that's just not something that I personally would be willing to invest my time into. One of the issues also with, like, Baldur's Gate 3 is it's a very, very heavily story-driven experience, where I do believe that this has a story to it, but I don't necessarily feel like it is the sole driving force in it. The open world, the exploration, the world design and stuff are things that are more appealing to me for Tainted Grail Fall of Avalon. And so while the story does intrigue me, it's not the thing that I am necessarily playing the game for. And so I'd be willing to absolutely pick it up and give it a try, and then probably put it down until I can play it from beginning to end. I like how much information they're giving about the early access content. Normally, it's just a disclaimer. It shows that they have a level of care and weight into it, instead of just like, yo, hey, I guess we're going to release this in this state. My problem is that I often like early access style of game more than the final product, and sometimes, especially with some glitches and bugs. Oh, because some you're like, I really love this, and then it gets changed by the final release. Totally understand as well. So that's Tainted Grail, The Fall of Avalon. It is releasing into early access. Like they said, there's about 10 to 15 hours of content that will be available in the first chapter of the game. They didn't mention how long the final product would be or how many chapters there necessarily would be. There is not a price available for the early access stage of this game at this point in time. But if you have interest in it, it is available. If you want to see the world in a more complete form, although it is with a different gameplay style, Tainted Grail Conquest is available. It's on Steam. I don't know if it's still available on Game Pass, but it is out there and available to you. Let me know what your thoughts are. If you have played Tainted Grail Conquest, how do you feel about this game? If you've played the demo of this game, how did you feel about it? Or after, if this is your first time being introduced to this, how do you feel? Is this something that you're interested in? Are you okay with early access? Are you put off by it? Put all your thoughts down in the comments below. If you want to keep up the conversation elsewhere, two great places to do so are Discord and Twitter. Speaking of Discord, we have a channel dedicated to these reactions where you can place links of your own that we can check out together live on stream, because we do stream on Twitch, and I would love to see you there. If you enjoyed this video, please leave it a like. If you want to catch future videos, please subscribe to the channel. If you watch one of the other videos on the channel, or if I see you in the live stream, thank you and enjoy.
All right. One more, everybody. One more. One more, and then we run the final battle, and then we raid and get out of here, and I find some food. I can't express how hungry I am beginning to get. But I also expected this stream to be done, like, at least an hour ago, but finishing Bayonetta took way longer than I expected. That's fine. I'm not angry at Bayonetta for that, but it definitely took longer than I expected. I have a food for you when you're done. Oh my god, Athena, you are an angel. Okay, I think I need to change shirts. I have one shirt in reserve anyway, so I will change shirts just in case. Cusco is king of the world. Cusco, you threw off my groove. Thank you for the lurk, reliable battles. All right. Put in your YouTube swans, your Pog swans, your Ree swans, or whatever other emote fits your fancy, whether it's from my channel, your channel, or anyone else's. It's going to be the last one. Checking out Dredge. Oh, all right, here we go. Greetings and salutations. My name is Michael Schwann, and today we're checking out Dredge. Now, according to Steam, this is a fishing exploration game with Lovecraftian elements to it. That's, what do you mean by fishing? Because when I think of fishing, I think of, like, fishing mini games. But if fishing is the game, what kind of fishing are we doing? And am I fishing up a Cthulhu? Is that what we're doing? Is my little friend here, can I get one of those on my boat? Like, how exactly is this working? I guess that's also part of what we're here to find out. So we'll go back to the initial preview trailer. This is from July of 2021. We do have 5 trailers to chew through. Let's go ahead and get started. It's cute art style. That looks like a fishing mini game, but we have like a Diablo style inventory. Survive? What are we surviving? Oh, you know, horrors of the deep. I have a friend who has thalassophobia very strongly, and I want to know how they would react to this scene right here of just sailing into nothing, and you can only see like 15 feet out from the boat because the fog has consumed you. Okay, next is the actual proper announcement trailer from August 2022.
Peggy 7.
A big nope, you're probably right. Oh yeah, get that net. Pull that net. Get the fish. Oh yeah, drop some cages. Hells yeah. I like that we're fishing from essentially what is like a tugboat. Oh, that's great. Oh, hell no. Oh, we're dead. Footage looks cute and wholesome. Music is depressing, just like me. Wait, did the boat fucking sink? No, that's just a sunken boat. Okay, I mean, it could be our boat, but there's a sunken boat there. I mean, you know, it's Lovecraftian, so it's gonna be a big bunch of nope.
It's going to be a big old bowl of nope. All right, so here is the Accolades trailer. This game isn't out yet. This game releases on March 30th. What?
Peggy 7.
Or a yep. Yeah, right? I love tentacles. Dredge is one of my most anticipated games in years. Ah, those kind of accolades. I was ready for them to throw up like a 10 out of 10 somewhere. I'd be like, huh? What a lovely pond of death. Dredge is holding secrets, and I very much want to work out what they are. Well, secrets are a big theme for Lovecraft. Lovecraftian works. All right, this is the release date reveal. 12. It makes me want to hug my screaming cry in despair. Some guy at the bar last night. I will give you a coin for your fish. I better go fish up something better. I got a better motor. I'm gonna go. I got a marlin. How much will you give me for a marlin? Oh, thanks. That's a nice pile. I'm gonna reinforce the boat. I found a squid with some glowy tentacles on it. It's still looking at you. It's still alive. All right. Thanks for the money. Reinforce the boat. I found some electric monstrosities. What's up? Oh, you gave me dollars. Thanks. I'll get a light so I can go into the more horrible parts of the local waters. I'll get you something truly amazing. I'm gonna fish up Cthulhu. That was a really good trailer. I liked that one. All right, here's the pre-order trailer from March 3rd.
Peggy 12.
Merch is just all over that. He's like, fuck yeah, man. I love this shit. Don't stare into it for too long. I like that this trailer seemed to have picked up right where the other one ended. I'm sure that's a fine box to fish up. The art style really gets you. I'm actually curious about this game despite my usual non-enjoyment of this style. Yeah, it's I can see where it is catching people's attention for sure. Oh. You know, if... nope. Oh, well, you're dead now. Dude touched the rock and was like, shouldn't have done that. I saw some bad things. The crab is trying so hard to warn people. No! Don't open it, bruv! I'm telling you, it's a bad idea! Don't do it! Okay, so it's available on Steam. It's also going to be available on Nintendo Switch, PlayStation 4 and 5, Xbox One, and Xbox Series S. It's also going to be available through Good Old Games. And it is priced on Steam at $25. It already has DLC. What is the DLC? There's the soundtrack, the art book, but there is the Blackstone Key. It is an in-game item. Unlocks the workshop on Blackstone Isle to receive two unique pieces of equipment. The arterial engine and the sign of ruin. It doesn't really even say what they do. So, either way, the base game's $25. I doubt this piece of DLC is terribly meaningful. It's probably just like... a boost of some sort. I do enjoy like the inventory system. It's very cute while also being extremely dour. You got some different fishing lines, some exploration. I assume you can be sunk in some way. Is this dude standing in a doorway in the middle of nothing, or is this a representation of being up at this dude's house? Horrible fish monsters, different locations of fishing. Use parts to research new equipment. Research equipment will appear for sale in shops. That's cool. And then the secrets of the island. Representation, I hope. Yeah, me too, right? Just walking up to some random doorway standing and a guy opens it and he's got glowing glasses holding a book. That's a nope door. You stay away from that. Either could be right in Lovecraft. You are correct. The soundtrack was pretty great for a D&D session. This is my kind of fishing game. Yeah, I can absolutely see where people are excited about that. That game looks like a grand old time. But remember that grand old times are not always good times. They are just grand and they are old. Much like the old gods themselves. Anyway, so that's Dredge. Out on everything. March 30th. Go check it out if you're interested. I think I'm interested. Cool. All right, anyway, so let me know what your thoughts are. Put them down in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you. If you want to keep up the conversation elsewhere, two great places to do so are Discord and Twitter. Speaking of Discord, we have a channel dedicated to these reactions where you can place links of your own that we can check out live on stream because we do stream on Twitch, and I would love to see you there. If you enjoy this video, please leave it a like. If you want to catch future videos, please subscribe to the channel. Do watch one of the other videos on the channel, or if I see you in the live stream, thank you and enjoy. My head was making a story about being in a Lovecraft now. Thanks for the images. I'm in Lovecraft with you. What do you mean? Opens room with a bed and a ton of tentacle appliances of all sorts? That probably exists already. What you just described probably already exists. All right. Battle! Fire! Hope that's the right spot. All right, where are we going, y'all? Where are we going? Who's online? Who's online on a Sunday night? Let's see. Didn't get in the battle due to making food. It's all right, Athena. We got there. We did it. My stomach itched. All right, and now I think we're on a super boss chapter. We are. Look at this layer of the camouflage with this big chameleon. No, you're like an axolotl. I don't know. This lizard scientist man. Wow, look at this bottom path. Loyalty gold chest, loyalty gold chest, loyalty scrolls chest. How tempting is that? Jeez, that's just a good path. Says the captain with 12,000 gold. Like, I need to start buying stuff more. Buy stuff. What can I upgrade? Did you see the name of the map? I did not. I will go peek at it in just a moment. I'm just spending my upgrades. Upgrading my fairy. And my shinobi. Oh man, I really forgot to appreciate my Zelda Game & Watch thingy. It's so neat to use during work. Oh, is it like a pocket version of the game? But like not like a Game Boy cartridge? Octopoggers! Oh my god. Alright, let me see where we're going. Go visit Liquid Music End. Shay's streaming. What are you streaming, Shay? Shay is streaming. Have a nice death. Liquid is working? Oh. Yeah, they crammed Zelda 1 and 2 and Link's Awakening into a golden Game & Watch style handheld. Oh, neat. Is anyone playing Nitro right now? Nuki? Is that where we need to go, Vandishar? Nuki Kabuchi? Nuchi Kabuchi? Nuki Kabuki? I don't recognize the name at all. Who's this? I know where we're going to go. We're going to go visit Epic Nerd Hype because I have not hung out with Epic Nerd Hype a whole lot, but I do interact with them on Twitter from time to time. So we're going to go head over there. So these are the socials, everybody. If you'd please follow me on Twitter or join the Discord. Also go check out the YouTube channel. Everything we record today will be becoming a YouTube video. We do have a new video going up every single day of the week, so go check it out if you want to see what else we've put up. We just today put up our review for Moonscars. So, with that said, this is also the raid message. If you are not a subscriber, you can unlock that raid emote for 100 channel points. It'll be available to you for the next 24 hours, including on the raid. I will be back live on Tuesday for 9 Years of Shadows. And then after we finish 9 Years of Shadows, we will start up Resident Evil 4 Remake. So I hope to see you back here for that. I'm going to go ahead and start the raid and play the credits. So thank you so much, everyone, for being here. I appreciate you a lot, and I will see you next time. Are you ending? No. It was just like a scene change. Okay. Have a good night, Vandishar. Have a good day, Herfuxig. Have a good day, Eve, since your morning is just starting, unless you're getting ready to go to bed. Whatever it is. France, if you're still lurking, have a good night. Everybody, have a good night. I appreciate you.